This evening on the Rock Newman Show, economist, educator, author, and political commentator, Dr. Julianne Malveaux shares her thoughts on the presidential race, President Obama's legacy, and whether or not his policies have helped the black community. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Dr. Julianne Malveaux is everywhere. You can catch her as a commentator on PBS, CNN, and TV1. She writes for Essence, USA Today, and Ms. Magazine. She earned a PhD in economics from MIT and holds a number of honorary degrees. And I have the honor of talking to her today on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome, and thank you for joining us today.
Rock, good to be with you always.
It's good to be with you. You have written another book. It is called, Are We Better Off? Race, Obama, and Public Policy by Julianne Malveaux, with a foreword by Donna Brazil. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
I want to go to something here. It says, often I want to applaud President Obama, give him a high five. Equally often, I want to shake him by the shoulders and say, brother, just what were you thinking? When do you want to give him a high five? When have you wanted to give him a high five? And when have you wanted to shake him?
High five. I remember my first year as president of Bennett College, and he had all the HBCU presidents at the White House, and they had a drum line. They had a drum line at the White House. And that was the bomb.
That was cool, right?
We were all sitting there like,
you know,
if we could do
the drum line.
And it was just amazing. Yeah. And of course, the national media saw that. It was a part of our culture and history that they had only seen caricatured. Movies, and our young people, the best and the brightest of them. And you just want to say, yes, brother. Mm-hmm. There have been other occasions. We recently saw him dance with a little lady, the 106-year-old lady. Yeah. The time that he hugged the young brother with the, you know, he said, your hair is just like mine.
Sure.
Instances like that where he embraces his culture. On the other hand.
And before you even go to the other hand for when you wanted to shake him, those things have been largely symbolic.
Yes. And that's a challenge. And that's a challenge. We fall in love as a people with symbol, but not substance. Mm-hmm. There have been too many opportunities for him to do substance that he's failed to do. Now, he has not lied to anybody. He never said he was going to be the black president. Mm-hmm. At the same time, when I think about the recovery funds and the fact that they went to states, STEM states who had the nerve to rebuff them, yeah. South Carolina said, we don't want the money, even though they had very high black unemployment rates. Why couldn't some of this money have gone to cities? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, people in cities are blacker and browner and older and younger and poorer. Mm-hmm. So going to cities would have been a way to accelerate recovery. The fact that he never talks about black unemployment, it's almost like he's allergic to the word black, like his lips might curl up and go in another direction if he says black. Just so many times when he's had the this last Supreme Court nomination. I mean, Marshall Garrett certainly seems to be Merritt Garrett. I'm getting his name all confused. But anyway, he seems to be quite capable. Yeah. But black women voted for President Obama 96%, 92%. We have got no ROI, except for the fact that we love to see Michelle looking good. Mm-hmm. So there's a thing of style versus substance. Yeah. We love the style, but the substance for us as a people is lacking.
I want to remember he won, he beat Hillary Clinton in 2008.
Yes.
And the anticipation from 2008 to his inauguration in January 20th, 2009, there was a sense of euphoria.
Yes.
In the black community, I'm going to say. And obviously, there was euphoria other places beyond the black community, mm-hmm. but I'm talking specifically now about the black community because your book really deals with whether or not the black community is better off. Are you better off today than you were 8 years ago? And we really want to get into that with some substance and some depth. You said that we have a tendency to fall in love with symbolism.
Mm-hmm.
This man winning the election on a Tuesday, and it was either Wednesday or Thursday, he went with the current mayor of D.C. at that time, Adrian Fenty, to Ben's Chili Bowl on U Street and sat in the seat where I always sit when I go in before he ever did it, to have his chili dog and whatever else he had. It was, again, symbolism mm-hmm. that a community, that the black community fell in love with. The inauguration was the largest attended inauguration ever. And African Americans, I don't know that there's been one collective event that I've seen a community come together with such enthusiasm, such joy, such anticipation, and interest as that first inauguration yeah. in the freezing cold.
In the freezing cold.
Black folks were out there.
And you could not find transportation. I'll tell you, one of your staff members just asked me if my nephew, Anye, who yeah. now is 32, but he was at the time, I don't know how old he was, whatever, mm-hmm. 32 minus 8, but
24.
He came to hang out with me. We got a ride down to the site. Yeah. We couldn't get a ride back. We mm-hmm. walked up, we walked from Capitol Hill back up 14th Street. Mm-hmm. You know where I, back up to 14th mm-hmm. and Q.
I'm a stereotype in general, black folks by and large don't like the cold.
No, and we were freezing. I think we must have stopped four times for coffee.
Can I stress once again how cold those two or three days
were?
We
had those football things that you put in, the football things that you put in your shoes yes. to make your feet warm.
Yes.
But the thing is, as you're walking up 14th Street, not only did you see the exuberance of our people, yeah. you saw more products that your imagination, yeah. you know, you had Obama pictures on velvet.
That's right.
You had,
that's right.
I believe I might have
mugs.
Seen some mugs. I saw some condoms.
Mercy.
I saw all kind of stuff. Anye at the time was working for Youth Radio, and so yeah. we actually did a little stop where we stopped in front of somebody's little kiosk and said, mm-hmm. what are you selling?
Yeah.
And the guy kept stuff. But mm-hmm. it, there was an exuberance.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think we thought it through. Mm-hmm. I think that, and that's kind of what I try to do within the book and the intro to the book. Because, you know, the book, as you've read, it's an intro, it's a set of columns, and then there's an epilogue that really tries to summarize, are we better off?
Mm-hmm.
And in the intro, I try to frame it in terms of what we were thinking.
Yeah.
And then as I have a section called, is this any way to treat a president? Mm-hmm. Talk about what other people were thinking, mm-hmm. Mitch McConnell, who, and then is this any way to treat your people? What mm-hmm. the president was thinking about us.
Mm-hmm.
Then the set of columns, and then the epilogue, which really deals with some of the numbers.
Yeah.
And when you're looking at some of the numbers, no, we're not better off. But the fact is that as you looked at this and you look at some of the framing, we were so happy. We had black folks who would start putting his picture up next to the JFK and Martin Luther King
yes,
pictures.
Yes.
You know, I'm like, where's Malcolm? But mm-hmm. that's another story. But mm-hmm. anyway, they, mm-hmm. you know, people, he was immediately deified.
Yeah.
Without him, he won the Nobel Prize without having done anything.
Mm-hmm.
And the symbolism of his presence was overarching, and at some level, that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
But at many levels, that did not force him to meet expectations about performance.
Mm-hmm.
And our community, you know, as I say in the book, you will not get fed in your mama's house if you don't bring your plate to the table.
Yeah.
So we didn't push him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the African-American yeah. leadership didn't push him. He treated the Congressional Black Caucus, in my opinion, disdainfully.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you were at that CBC dinner when he told people to put on their marching shoes.
Mm-hmm.
I found that so insulting mm-hmm. that you're telling John Lewis
yeah.
to put on his marching shoes, yeah. John Lewis.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're thinking to yourself, brother, please, that was one of those shake you, you know, sort of moments.
Does it point to what you're talking about here? Because, well, you know, we've got 2 days worth of stuff to talk about, and we got to do it. We have to do it in less than an hour. Does it indicate that black folks, the black community, is not yet politically sophisticated? because President Obama received in the 90 plus percentile of the African-American vote. To this day, if he were to run a third time, it would probably still approach the same amount. Mm-hmm. And a shrewd political analyst might say, why are you doing that when, in fact, you can measure that for the political support that you gave him, you have not received benefits for that political support?
You know, Rock, it's such a good point that you make about political sophistication. At the same time, let me say, as cynical as I'm accused of being, I don't regret my votes for President Obama. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I could not have ever voted for John McCain. Right. You would have to take my fingers off sentiment by or Mitt Romney, Mr. Mm-hmm. 47%. Mm-hmm. So what
now,
I
while
say,
while you're there, this is obviously speculation and conjecture. But you say you couldn't vote for John McCain, who he ran against, whose running mate was the great Sarah Palin, and later on, Mitt Romney, switching Mitt. But would Hillary Clinton have been a better president?
Perhaps. Perhaps. I think that Hillary Clinton would have been better able to deal with matters of race because mm-hmm. she's a white woman.
Mm-hmm.
Because
and I was going to say, would she have been a better president for black, for
because
the black
I
community?
Think this black man felt constrained about what he could say about race. I think that as soon as he got the attacks, he started backing up. And anytime he was attacked on race matters, you think about Skip Gates and the beer summit. Mm-hmm. What sense does it, someone breaks into your house? I mean, someone arrests you because you're right. breaking into your own house. President has an opinion, which almost any black man would have. Excuse me, this is just not right. And the police unions then start saying, piling on, and mm-hmm. so he backpedals.
Talk to me about, a little bit about, because you bring that up, talk to me about the conundrum that he, as a black man, is restrained by the nature of the country that we live in. He is restrained about unabashedly moving forward the black agenda. Talk to me about that.
Well, you know, think about it. When Harry Reid talked about him, he talked about him not having Negro dialect, mm-hmm. Being articulate. What mm-hmm. was he contrasting him to? Maybe Jesse Jackson, who also does not have Negro dialect and is also very articulate. But there is no question in anybody's mind that Reverend Jesse Jackson is a black man.
Yeah.
There is no question in anybody's mind that Reverend Al Sharpton is a black man. But you had this brother who could kind of blend in. And if you looked at his 2004 speech, brilliant speech, but he said, I'm not for black America. I'm paraphrasing. Black America, white America,
red
was
America,
one America.
With, America
yeah, it was
right.
one mm-hmm. America. Mm-hmm. And so he put himself out there as, I'm going to be the president of everybody.
Of everybody.
Having put yourself out there as a president of everybody, you have the luxury to be the champion for the GBLT community, as he was with marriage equality. Mm-hmm. You have the luxury to be the champion of the Latino community around immigration issues,
right.
which he certainly was.
Right.
You have the luxury in your first legislation to come out for women's issues with a Ledbetter, with the whole thing about pay equity.
Mm-hmm.
But where is your luxury to say anything about black people? And that is a luxury that he did not take, I think because he was afraid or because his advisors tried to turn him into someone who was race neutral.
Hmm.
And race neutrality means you don't own race.
Mm-hmm.
But race is. Race exists. I have a whole little rant in there when I talk about the existence of race and its persistence in our nation and the fact that we still see the 2-to-1 unemployment rate. We still see, you know, just, you know, any day. We don't have to pick a day. Any day you can wake up in the morning and pick up the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Postman,
mm-hmm.
you know, in Queens,
mm-hmm.
delivering the mail.
Mm-hmm.
Four white boys just seem like they ain't got nothing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse my Ebonics, but every now and then we go there.
Yeah.
They have yeah. nothing to do, so they arrest this brother, deliver the mail, because mm-hmm. he yelled at them because they almost hit him.
Mm-hmm.
So every single day there's something. And what we see is the abuse of power. And what we as black people might have liked was a president who at least every now and then would draw a line. Now he drew a line occasionally. When he went down to South Carolina and he sang Amazing Grace, you know, there was a line drawn. he communicated with the community in a way that made us all feel warm and fuzzy and empathetic. Mm-hmm. I don't know that I only want to feel warm and fuzzy and empathetic.
And the political process, and when I use that term, a lack, not that the black community not being politically sophisticated, the reality is that the Republican Party clearly demonstrates, we don't give a damn about you. You
Hello.
You ain't at the top of our agenda or the bottom. You ain't on our agenda. They make that plain.
Mm-hmm.
The Democratic Party has the, unfortunately, as I see it, the Democratic Party has the luxury of taking the vote for granted.
You know, Rock, what's going to eventually have to happen, and I this is always a dilemma. I'm now, I have been attending Democratic conventions since 1972.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 62 years old. Thank God I wasn't supposed to live this long. I started so much mess. supposed to be gone a while ago. But, and I've seen us year after year after year, and election after election, hold our nose and go for the lesser of two evils.
Yeah.
Knowing full well that perhaps a third party option would be a good option, but fearing that sitting out an election yeah. by going to a third party yeah. would yield us a Trump mm-hmm. or a Trump mm-hmm. or a Romney or, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, we look at, you know, Rainbow Push Coalition. And, you know, I've been pleased to work with Rainbow since I was a Jackson delegate in 1984.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, all Ron, the great, late, great Ron Walters, who was, of course, you know, one of the doyens of this campus,
sure.
Talked about, you know, how could we do third party politics? But we've always been too frightened of the short run results
mm-hmm.
to deal with the long run implications of sitting out.
Mm-hmm.
Make them court us.
Mm-hmm.
And we've never been able to make them court us. So we get peanut butter crackers.
Mm-hmm.
We get crumbs, and we're happy to have the crumbs because we, in our minds, don't think we even needed to have that.
Mm-hmm.
And that becomes a dilemma, Brock. And you know, we're contemporaries. We've been around the block the
sure.
same number of times, and we've seen this.
Sure.
And we've seen the angst and the pain in our community, and it's going to happen again.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, we've got the Bernie is talking a good game.
Mm-hmm.
Hillary is being Hillary. I have, the end of the book has a section called 2016 and beyond.
Yeah.
These are the questions you have to ask anybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't care if they're Bernie, Hillary, Trump,
mm-hmm.
Ryan, Cruz,
mm-hmm.
ask them these questions. If they can't answer the questions, they don't deserve our vote.
I'd like to have you to respond to this. I have a Facebook friend who is, by pretty much any measure, a sophisticated political commentator, I would say, on Facebook.
Okay.
well read. He's run for public office. I thought he should have done a lot better. Didn't have a lot of name recognition, and you know,
and maybe money.
Yeah, that was definitely a part of it. He is vociferous in his support of Bernie Sanders and saying to African Americans that if you would look at the record of Bernie Sanders and look at the record of Hillary Clinton. And look and listen to what they're saying right now, that Bernie Sanders by far is speaking a language that would be more beneficial to the African-American community than what Hillary Clinton is saying. So why are you so lockstep with Hillary Clinton? And your response would be?
Well, I'm not lockstep with anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of us are. I will be supporting the Democratic nominee,
mm-hmm.
whoever he or she may be.
Mm-hmm.
I don't live on the Clinton plantation,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of other folks don't. But if you look at the Clinton record, there are the Bill Clinton record, and then we have to distinguish that. And
mm-hmm.
I think that's also important. Many people, Michelle Alexander wrote a great piece in The Nation. Danny Glover and I were on KPFK yesterday. He, of course, is a great Bernie Sanders supporter.
Mm-hmm.
And they're imputing Bill Clinton's record to Hillary Clinton.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that's fair.
Mm-hmm.
I think that when you look at the continuum of their issues analysis, that Hillary has always been a bit to the left of Bill.
Mm-hmm.
Now, she has been in bed with Wall Street. We can't deny that. The
mm-hmm.
record speaks for itself. She is more of a hawk
mm-hmm.
than certainly Bernie Sanders would be.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, her vote for the war
right.
certainly speaks to that. But I think that people are looking also at things like winnability. Mm-hmm. When you use words like democratic socialist in the context of American politics, mm-hmm. It's very challenging for mainstream people to put their hands around what a democratic socialist is unless Mr. Sanders, Senator Sanders, defines it properly, mm-hmm. which he has not done. I don't have a problem. I tell people I'm a socialist all the time,
yeah.
because I'm a redistributionist.
Yes.
And anybody who wants to take tax money from one person, give, that's redistribution. Mm-hmm. Now, you can call it socialism, you can call it not, but it is whatever it is.
I mean, and so much of what we experience and live in this country has
socialistic roots.
Absolutely.
You know, when you're talking, so I don't find that objectionable. I think that Bernie is saying some great things. Mm-hmm. I wrote a piece, a couple months ago called Head Hillary, Heart Bernie. And I got phone calls off the ying from people saying, oh, you endorse Bernie Sanders. Mm-hmm. I didn't. I said mm-hmm. that he's speaking the language that I want to hear about economic reform, mm-hmm. which Hillary
political
was not speaking.
Political revolution, so to speak.
And so he's been speaking that, and I think it's a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, I've got three challenges with Bernie Sanders. Number one, he has not told me how he's going to pay for this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you can talk anything. How are you going to pay for it? Now, he's talked about when the corporations go offshore and they manufacture offshore, that he has a way to capture those taxes.
Mm-hmm.
I need to see more details. I've looked at the working papers that he has online.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not satisfied.
Yeah.
But in any case, he does have ideas, but I'm so sad. Hey, the whole issue of how you pay for the free tuition, all of these things.
Sure.
So that's number one. Number two,
Health and universal, true universal health care.
Yeah. Number two, the black people in Vermont do not like him.
Mm.
And that concerns me.
Mm.
If you look at his record,
You mean the four that live there?
Rock, it's probably 12.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, it's...
No, but I get your point.
But you know, there's an NAACP there, there's a Burlington NAACP, there have been a couple articles written. And I won't say that they are not, he has not made himself familiar with them.
Mm-hmm.
He, I think, essentially looks at issues from an economic perspective, but not from a race perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to look at both.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, capitalism and racism are intertwined.
Absolutely.
And he has to deal with that. And he wants to deal with the excesses of capitalism without looking at racism. As an economist,
mm-hmm.
that very much concerns me.
Mm-hmm.
I would have a series of questions for him as I outline. Who are the black people who work for you?
Mm-hmm.
Not as your receptionist on Capitol Hill, but chief of
staff,
head of your environmental,
mm-hmm.
something like that. You know,
mm-hmm.
senators and congresspeople, they have 20, 30 people on their staffs
mm-hmm.
right there.
Mm-hmm.
So you're Washington, D.C. You can't tell me you can't find black people
right.
to do work in Washington, D.C.
Right.
So what's that about? So did you just discover black people
mm-hmm.
when you decided that
mm-hmm.
you wanted to be president of the United States? So,
mm-hmm.
you know, A, like I said, I'm looking, you know, at the whole issue of how you pay for it. B, I'm looking with the issue of, you know, how you play with black people.
Mm-hmm.
And then C, I'm looking at the issue of how you get along.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, what are your senatorial colleagues saying about you? Who's endorsed you? You can have all the brilliant ideas you want.
Mm-hmm.
What we've learned from President Obama
mm-hmm.
is that you have brilliant ideas,
mm-hmm.
but if the people say, this ain't happening.
Yeah. If then some it's kind of way you can't find consensus.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that he can. Now, the third issue is less of an issue for me than one and two.
Mm-hmm.
And I will say, I like what Bernie Sanders is saying. I have endorsed nobody.
Mm-hmm.
I have, not that my endorsement matters to anybody, but I am looking at this as an analyst, as a commentator, drinking it in,
mm-hmm.
finding it. You know, there's a Chinese characters says, may you live in interesting times.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, we got that.
Yeah, yes, we
do. I mean,
and
you know.
Speaking of those interesting times, I walk into a restaurant that had an outdoor patio. This was 2 weeks ago. And there's a guy there who was sounding as if he had a little too much to drink. And the first sound I heard was, Trump will beat Hillary Clinton's butt.
And he didn't say butt.
Yeah, he didn't say butt, but we on PBS. So, he was maybe mid-60s.
Okay.
Okay, so I looked at that and I'm like, okay. Now, he was there with his college-age granddaughters.
Okay.
I asked a few questions.
Rock Newman, be a Rock Newman. You ask a few questions.
They went to the University of Maryland. Okay. They were college age, 19, 20, 20. They were as rabid in their support of Donald Trump as their granddad was, which it really made me pause and to say, you know, he's bridging a gap that one might ordinarily think that the enlightened 20-year-old, what is it about Donald Trump that you might, with all that he is saying and all that he is not saying, with his display of a lack of command and knowledge about world affairs, when he was asked, what is the federal government's number three, top
right.
three priorities?
But he's a security
he
security.
Said, first he said, security, security, security. And then he couldn't, for a quick second, it seemed as if he couldn't even think of the other two. But then he said, security, healthcare,
and education.
And education.
And then he said, and send that back to the states. So that meant, what does the feds do?
It was so much of a non-answer and a bad answer. And it is typical of what he has, in my observation, what he has demonstrated.
Rock, you know, I was cracked. First, I was beating myself. I'm like, why are you watching this? You have work to do. Go to your desk and do your work. Mm-hmm. But I really wanted to see Kasich because I liked the format that Anderson Cooper had of having them each do one-on-one as opposed to have those crazy debates where nobody says anything.
Right.
His whole demeanor was inappropriate, beginning with his defense of his campaign manager who pushed the young woman who, you know, Trump said, look at the video. Well, we looked at the video and we saw it. But here's what I think is going on with a lot of people. First of all, he's in your face. And I think a lot of people like that. I think a lot of people, I don't know why they like it, but a lot of people like it. Secondly, I think people are tired of politics as usual. We've got gridlock on Capitol Hill. People haven't seen a lot get done. Now, the gridlock is of its own making.
Right.
The Mitch McConnells and Paul Ryans of the world have decided that anything that President Obama puts out there, they're not going to do, no matter what it was. But that gridlock is frustrating to Tea Party people who thought, we elected y'all, now deliver.
Yeah.
It's frustrating to other people as well. And Trump just throws it out there. I mean, he's uncouth. He is ignorant. He is any extreme that you could say. But he gets laugh lines. He's a media maven, and I think people like that. I'm surprised that the 20-somethings are as enamored of him as their 60-something-year-old grandfather is, but I'm not stunned because I think, you know, when we look at some of this, people are just confused about our politics. Mm-hmm. And part of it is, Rock, about 20 years ago, we stopped teaching civics in high school. So people don't, you remember those, I'm sure you may or may not, some of your viewers might, those legislative rock commercials.
Oh, absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
How does a bill become a law and all those things.
Sure.
I don't think that people really understand that. And so people think of voting as the most they can do. When voting is really the least they can do. I mean, you know from your long association with former Mayor Marion Barry, you know, as the premier activists of this city, that there has to be continuing involvement in the process.
Engagement.
You've got to be there at the city council meetings. You have to get your legislators to come do town halls. And these, you got a generation who believes they show up every 4 years and vote for president. They don't look at the down ticket. And the down ticket determines their quality of day-to-day life more than the up ticket does. President Obama's election or Hillary's or Bernie's or heaven forbid Trump's, is not going to determine the quality of the water you drink. You're going to have to come further down the list to do that. And so I think that, you know, with that absence of understanding of civics, with an absence of civic education, people become extremely excited about the every 4 year thing without looking at the day-to-day thing. I need to see more young people running for office, Rock. I don't care what side of the aisle they're on, although of course you know what my preferences are, but I need to see more young people running for office. I need to see more young people on school boards. I mean, this is what determines the day-to-day quality of life. What young people get to read, what's in their libraries.
I am concerned as an observer of what I think is an unmistakable element of retrenchment and retreat from the civil rights days when there seemed to be advancement and improvement in race relations. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that there is more overt racism being demonstrated in 2015 and 16 than there was in 1970, 1980, 1990, 2000. Now, as an exercise, when I take long trips and I do drive long distances, I will turn on conservative radio. Mm-hmm. It's almost another name for that I would describe as hate radio, because what you hear is alarming from the major radio voices, whether it's Sean Hannity or Rush Limbaugh or Levin or Michael Savage. What you hear from them is alarming. What you hear riding through Alabama, riding through Mississippi and Oklahoma from the more local stations, I mean, they stopped just short of using the N-word in their rants. And I'm wondering and how you would respond to the proliferation of right-wing radio and what has been the Breitbarts of the world, as to what that has done to seriously damage race relations improving.
It was interesting. The election of President Obama, and I deal with it a little bit in the intro to the book, what I talk about, is this any way to treat a president? The election of President Obama seemed to unleash the virulent racism on the part of the far right, who just could not stand the notion, couldn't stand it, that there was a black president. Yeah. So you had a pastor in Phoenix, Arizona, who was praying from his pulpit for the president's death.
Yeah.
You had so-called respectable members of Congress who were Mitch McConnell, my first priority is to make sure he doesn't get a second term.
And they plan
you're sitting, well, you're sitting here in the middle of a recession. The unemployment rate overall at double digits. Mm-hmm. We need black unemployment rate in the 20s. With people losing homes, you know, like people losing pennies out of their pocket. With social cities having challenges meeting, you know, obligations to their elders. And your number one priority is to make sure this man doesn't get a second term.
Right.
Your number one priority is not to make sure people find jobs or this.
Right.
And I think that it just unleashed some of the things we heard. Congressman Joe Wilson from South Carolina, you lie on the floor of Congress.
Yeah.
There was another one from Michigan who had the temerity to talk about Michelle Obama's body in demeaning terms that had he done it to Laura Bush or even Hillary, white women, it would not have gone down that way. And so I think that this was unleashed and it was the defensive reaction. But you're right, I don't drive as much as you do, but occasionally I hit the road and ride down to like North Carolina or something, and you listen to some of this radio and you shudder. Or you have encounters with people, and the encounters would make you laugh if they weren't so serious. In Greensboro, when I was living there, we lost an African-American woman had been mayor, and she lost her reelection bid by about 900 votes. That was black folks' fault. We didn't really come out. Mm-hmm. The 900 votes were there. But I was out the next day, and a woman said, she didn't know I was there. She said, well, you know, black people think they have everything. They have the president, they have the school board, the police chief is black, but now we have a white mayor. Isn't that a good thing? Uh-huh. And I walked out of the dressing room and looked at her. I didn't say a word, I just looked at her and said to myself, you have revealed yourself, sister. But, you know, clearly it's people feeling that something has been taken from them and they want to take it back.
And going back to Trump for a moment, he hit that code, that not so coded language of make America great again.
Yes.
I think speaks to those people that are angry and who have been convinced, and it probably didn't take a whole lot of convincing, but convinced that something has been taken from them. And seeing the browning of the country, there the lady who just passed away, they had the big memorial.
Francis Cress Welsing, Dr. Francis Cress, wonderful.
She spoke to that issue of the fear that white people have about losing the identity as the majority in this country. And it takes somebody well above my pay grade to figure out that psychology. But I think Trump has tapped into that anger.
It doesn't take anybody above your pay grade. You've lived in this country long enough to know that when you're used to being in charge, and suddenly you're not in charge, this requires a paradigm shift. So you used to be all that in a bag of chips. It used to be given that your white male self was it. You would not be challenged by women. You would not be challenged by people of color. You'd not be challenged by the GBLT community. You are it.
Frederick Douglass said power concedes nothing without a struggle. Demand.
It never did, and it never will. Right. Those who want freedom without agitation are like those who want the ocean without its mighty roar. So this is a process of struggle. And there, nobody, power is not like peanuts at a cocktail party. You don't say, Malveaux, please pass the power, and I hand it over to you like it's peanuts. And so you have people who are resisting because they had all the power. And I can, we see it in this city with the gentrification and the ways that there has been accommodation to some of the gentrification to basically bow down and say, okay, we're gonna usher much of our black population out of here for various and sundry reasons. We see it in education, in the higher education, where, for example, in public universities, what you're seeing is a legislative changes of attendance requirements so that the legislature will say you can't go to North Carolina Central, as an example, University of Virginia, without a 3 point what GPA. Whereas prior, admissions officers and others had the flexibility to admit somebody who might be very promising, but maybe had a few challenges in high school. But when you legislatively do it, you're dealing with something totally different. It's like saying, let us close the ranks and let's make sure that nobody comes in. And I think that the nobody, certainly not I don't know about you, I never thought I'd see a black president in my lifetime. You know, if you asked me 20 years ago, I was
No. Yeah, right.
So we have one. But what we also have had is a major backlash to this president. And that backlash has manifested itself in a virulent racism that is very visible. And we see it even, you know, Black Enterprise has a article in this month's magazine where they show 1916 and 2016 in terms of changes in voting rights laws. So what we see has been the retrenchment of the Voting Rights Act.
An alarming rollback.
And so that, you know, 4 years ago or 8 years ago, you would have seen preachers taking their congregation to the polls on Sunday. Now the number of Sundays where they can go has been restricted. Or you'd see people being able to register up until a week or two before, but now it's a month before. So making it more difficult for people to exercise the franchise. In some southern states, you've seen actually the number of polling places reduced so that as opposed to walking around the corner or going up the street, you might have to drive 30 miles.
Yeah, there's been a process of making it much more difficult to vote. I don't know if I'm going to ask you to choose sides on this, but as an astute political observer, I'm certainly going to ask for your commentary. Cornel West has been a vociferous and consistent critic of Obama policies.
Yes.
And he's been vociferously attacked by traditional civil rights people. Talk to me about that.
You know, and I talk about it a little bit in the book. Cornell is a dear friend. We're contemporaries. He also from California. He's from Sacramento. I'm from San Francisco. We were in the Boston area at the same time. He at Harvard, me at MIT. Brilliant brother. There is some substance to what he's saying. But I frankly think that there's a piece of it that's personal, and that's what bothers me. You don't get to talk about somebody's daddy. And Cornell, in some of his criticism, has gone on to say that the president has daddy issues. I think that's inappropriate. I want to, if you look at the work that I've done, I talk about public policy. You know, and I think that part of our challenge as black people is that even when you simply talk about public policy, some people, you know, you're anti-black, I've had folks who say, well, I'm not going to buy your book because you don't like Obama. I'm like, no, frankly, I'm enamored of the brother, but I wish he had done better. I asked, are we better off? And there's a line in the book that one of my favorite lines, of course, that's narcissistic to say one of my favorite lines, but I say, yes, we can. And I said, no, you didn't. We're not better off, but blessedly, we're not worse off. Yeah. But you missed an opportunity, and he did miss an opportunity. But I think that Cornell has taken it to another level by taking the public policy and adding the personal. Mm-hmm. Now, they did have a personal relationship, and I'm not privy to all of that, and I know that there are people who were disappointed at the way that he responded, and you don't know if that's the president or his people, but I know that Cornell did quite a bit, you know, with the first campaign, and maybe feels that he wasn't sufficiently rewarded. I understand he, you know, did a lot of surrogate speaking and other things like that. That still doesn't allow you to, again, the personal is inappropriate. But the civil rights community, we have to be able to have analysis. We cannot say this president does not walk on water.
Yeah.
Nobody walks on water. Mm-hmm. You know, if I've got something that is flawed in the work that I do, bring it. Let me know. Let me improve it. And I think that that's the spirit in which some have approached President Obama, but the people inside the White House have been such that if you say boo negative about the president, they shut you down. Cornell West could be a very important voice of advice for the president. And but at the same time, like I said, the personal piece is inappropriate.
I can't tell people from where I sit, because rules and regulations and otherwise, to go buy a book. And so I can't, so I won't. I just know that looking at this, are we better off? And as I have looked through and read this book, I know that I am significantly more informed about substance, about policy, than I was before I read this book. So I want to thank you for what you've given me with this. And I want to encourage people that if they want to be more informed, this is a possible source of how they. Now, I ain't telling nobody about the book.
I got you. But they can read it.
But I needed to say I needed to say that. And as we talk about substance and policy, an irritant for me, and I don't even know if I'm supposed to say this, but I'm going to say it, and that is what appears to be President Obama's tone deafness, lack of sensitivity, appreciation, and understanding for the incredible value of HBCUs.
Don't get me started.
I want you to start.
Don't get me started.
Because I can't.
Well, you know,
I want you to talk about that.
Well, you know, I spent 5 years of my life as an HBCU president.
Yes.
It was probably one of the most rewarding times of my life because I love black people. Mm-hmm. I love education. Education is a bridge that we walk across and we go back to our history. I was stunned to think that an African-American man would cut spending to HBCUs through our Title III dollars. Stunned. The first skirmish he had with the HBCU community was there was an $85 million fund that President Bush had put together, and he wanted to close it down. Now, Bush never said the money was going to be there forever, but how do you get more from Bush than you would get from Obama? Mm-hmm. So the first thing we had to do as a community was to say, and understanding all the things that HBCU presidents do, this became yet another issue, yet another fight. Mm-hmm. They did relent, and the $85 million stayed, but then because of sequestration and other things, and there's a table in the back of the book, we saw the dollars coming to HBCUs drop. Mm-hmm. In addition, President Obama appointed a man who's now the president of Morehouse College, Dr. John Sylvanus Wilson, whose role as president, or what is he, the executive director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs, was not what we had been accustomed to. When Catherine LeBlanc, who had been appointed by President Clinton, was head, she literally went from government department saying, where's the money for HBCUs? Do you have contracts for HBCUs? Departments had goals. Mm-hmm. Women's Bureau, Department of Labor, Department of Agriculture. So many dollars should be going to HBCUs. That's a great. Wilson didn't do that. Instead, he scolded us about how we should be more efficient. And we had to have ROI and all of that. As many presidents, a couple brothers in particular, Earl Richardson, who at the time was president of Bowie, had written that you're comparing apples and oranges. Yeah. Rock, I had students who, it took them 8 years to graduate, but guess why? Because they would come and stay in school as long as their money lasted. Mm-hmm. Then they stop out and save some more money. Then they come back and stay in school as long as their money lasted. And so it's unfair to compare that kind of a student right. to someone whose mom and daddy are paying for them to go to American University mm-hmm. and they get finished in 4 years. Yeah. There were no accommodations. Arne Duncan, in my opinion, was basically hostile mm-hmm. to HBCUs. The whole Parent PLUS debacle cost the HBCU community to lose 28,000 students. You hear me? Yeah. And most of our schools are tuition driven, yeah. which means that between half and 70% of our revenue come from tuition. So if you lose 28,000 students, then how many millions of dollars are being lost? And what do you do? Some of us, I have colleagues and mentors who would not send students home because once you've been to school for 5 weeks, sending you home is devastating. Yeah. And you've been there for 5 weeks anyway, yeah. so yeah. stay. But then from the regulators, if you have kept someone who didn't pay, you get ding for that. So you're sitting there stuck between a rock and a hard place. And
I'm trying to figure something out. And I don't know if you have the answer, but I'll bring it up in case you might. Has anyone ever explained or have you heard President Obama talk about the reasoning for this lack of support and for policies that seem to me to diminish the strength and the viability and the sustainability of black colleges?
You know, I think that President Obama has surrounded himself at some level with the wrong people. Clearly, he's an Ivy Leaguer. He went to Columbia. He went to Harvard. Been there, done that, a whole lot of us. But without Michelle is his black card, mm-hmm. Without being coarse. But Michelle yeah. is Michelle, Jeremiah White, right? These are things that he acquired in adulthood. Mm-hmm. These are things that he did not yeah. grow up in.
Right.
And so there was nobody really to tell him the HBCU story and why it's valuable. Mm-hmm. We would not have black doctors, as you know, there not been a Howard University med school. You have, even today, HBCUs represent 3% of our nation's colleges, mm-hmm. but 20% mm-hmm. of our graduates.
Yeah.
And when you look at black women who are going to get PhDs in STEM careers,
yeah.
more than almost half of them, and mm-hmm. my numbers may be a little off, mm-hmm. but a preponderance of them
come
from HBCUs.
Any fair analysis of the numbers speak to their incredible value to the, not just the black people, but to the society.
And a continuing value. And we have the opportunity, especially in the private world of HBCUs, and I've lived this, of having some young person come who basically didn't have it all together in high school,
mm-hmm.
give them a chance.
Mm-hmm.
I had a young lady come in with a 1.7. And, you know,
yeah.
I'm sitting there, my admissions people looking at me like, Dr. Malveaux, have you lost your mind?
Yeah.
But there was something about the little sister that made me say,
mm-hmm.
give her a chance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I'm a
mm-hmm.
high school put out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, I ain't finished
yeah.
nobody's school. So, yeah. well, that's right. a whole other story.
Yeah.
But in any case, I'm like, give her a chance. There was something about her first semester. 3.3 GPA.
Mm-hmm.
Second semester, 3.6 GPA.
Mm-hmm.
This girl was rolling. All she needed was a chance.
Yeah.
But I just don't think that the president has had the people around him.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at his circle, who in his circle went to an HBCU other than Dr. Wilson at the White House Initiative, who clearly was what I would call an HBCU elitist. I mean,
mm-hmm.
there's some folks who believe that only Howard, Spelman, Morehouse, Tuskegee, and Hampton are worth saving. And there are 105 HBCUs, and in my own experience, I know that most of them are worth saving, if not all of them.
I need to take a moment, because I want to read an excerpt here. President Barack Obama has not met the expectations of many who were excited about his election. Even as I acknowledge the opposition he's had to face and hurdles he had to clear, even as I recognize hindsight is 2020, I am both saddened and disappointed by these years since President Obama has been elected. He electrified us with the mantra, yes, we can. And in some ways he did. With the Affordable Care Act, he expanded the social contract for the first time in several decades. Yes, he did not change the relative material condition of African-American people. Yes, he can. No, he didn't. President Obama didn't push black folks backwards, but he missed the opportunity to move us forward. Now, if you can for us, that's a strong indictment. And we've got about 5 minutes left. If you can talk to us as to he didn't push us backwards, but he didn't push us forward, how you come to that conclusion?
Well, Rock, in the epilogue of the book, I look at just pure numbers. Yeah. I look at poverty, which is higher now than it was when President Obama came in. Mm-hmm. Black child poverty, higher now than when President Obama came in. Incomes flat. And with black people, just a little bit, you know, well, flat. Let's just call it flat, mm-hmm. As they were when he came in. Mm-hmm. Although it's an interesting footnote, the few more black people earn more than $200,000 a year. A few more, like 1% more. But a lot more earn less than $15,000 a year. So mm-hmm. again, you see the same bifurcation right. in our community that you see overall when you talk about the widening gap. Right. Home ownership, we lost, you know, trillions of dollars worth of home value. That was wealth. Mm-hmm. Unemployment rates have gone down, but the gap has remained what it was. Mm-hmm. Of course, the Affordable Care Act is his signature accomplishment, and you have more of us who are covered under the Affordable Care Act. But the bottom line is, for if you were to stand anywhere and ask anybody, from a material perspective, people are not better off. Our young people are graduating with tens of thousands of dollars worth of student loan debt. The data say $30,000 average, but since half of all students don't have student loan debt, that means for the remaining half is something that looks closer to 60. And our kids, especially African-American kids, are taking longer to finish because of this whole issue of student loan debt. What might this president have done differently? Well, he had my biggest, if you will, challenge. He had 2 years where he could have done a cakewalk. Yeah. He had the Senate and the House yeah. between 2009 and 2011. Yeah. He had both. Yeah. What happened? He tried to make friends with people who didn't want to be his friend. Mm-hmm. He was sitting there winking and blinking at Republicans talking about, you know, kumbaya. Yeah. Well, kumbaya in a quarter will not even get you an issue of the Washington Post. Mm-hmm. So why are you going there? And then he looks up, Senator Kennedy has died. He has to make all kind of compromises to get a weakened version of the Affordable Care Act. Mm-hmm. And then his hands are tied. People are angry because he spent all the political capital on health care yeah. when some of that capital should have been spent on jobs. Mm-hmm. That was a signature failure. I mean, I think that that's where we paid the price for his political inexperience. Mm-hmm. And I think that what we've seen amazing growth in him. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not a haterator.
Yeah.
And that's not a word, but I'm not a hater. Yeah. But, you know, we've seen this growth. We've seen increased political acumen. But we've also seen an unwillingness to engage at a certain level. Right now, Rock, what is it? It's 2016. He's got another 11 months. Yeah. And he could put a dashiki on, put his fist up and say, Ungao Black Power.
Yeah.
And they couldn't do anything to him.
Yeah.
In other words, there are things that he could do with executive orders to target.
Yeah. You know, and there's a big question about whether or not he's going to become more aggressive in this remaining 10 months that he has. I'd like to think, I'm pretty sure that he and Michelle sit down every Wednesday night and watch the Rock Newman Show.
I sure hope they do.
So knowing that, thinking that they do that, once, I think Jimmy Carter, I'll give you another observation. I think Jimmy Carter is by far the greatest ex-president of our lifetime. We have 2 years left. I mean, we have 2 minutes left here mm-hmm. now. I'd like you to speak to President Obama, who will become former President Obama, and what he might do in his post-presidency to make up for what you analyze that he didn't accomplish during his terms.
Well, President Obama, if you're watching, let me say two things to you. First of all, thank you for your service. We would say that always. But, you know, I like Mo better. Before you leave, please appoint a John Hope Franklin Commission on Reparations to study reparations in this country. The Institute for the Black World has asked for this time and again, and you can do this. It will make a difference. We need to begin to study why we have a wealth gap among African-American people in our country. But once you leave the White House, you've talked about education for boys and girls. Let's talk about job readiness. Let's talk about dollars for education, and let's talk about the many ways that you can make a difference. Please don't go to Morehouse College or any other college again and tell black men to pull up their pants. Go to Morehouse College and give people hope and opportunity. Come, and Michelle, please come to our young sisters and let them know that they're enough. You all are amazing role models, and you can make more of a difference than you have. If you use those 8 years as a foundation, I have great expectations that you can do much more and say much more. And you know what? Once you're out of the office, tell the truth.
I really want to thank you for all that you continue to do and for joining us here today on the Rock Newman Show. And like before, I want to get another commitment from you that you'll come back again.
Anytime, Rock.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless, and I'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.